money is very boring subject. However, it is linked somehow, we are going to discover and discuss, with power, different types of power, and with values. So the setup of the session is to discuss the following issues: characteristics, what make money unique, effective instrument for interconvertibility, that we can exchange money for good services and then get also empower certain areas of activities, and this way exercise social power. Then how do money, and politics, power interact each other? I would set even more ambitious goal, how to make money to play a positive role in politics and to empower society. And the third question, what are the remedies for increasing concentration of wealth and power that constitutes the base for a plutocracy? And final question, how can the wider distribution of money be used to support more rapid and equitable social development? So these are the issues, and I will try to share my views as an economist, and then I would try to avoid to use monetarist approach to move in details, but I would like to start with a brief history how money became as important instrument and the important factor of our life. So we economists believe, and I think that besides us, many other people believe that money is the greatest economic innovation. And these days, money plays three major functions. As a medium of exchange, medium of exchange and a measure of value, unit of an account, and a store of value. And when we look at the beginning of money, money appeared as early as people started producing surpluses to share, to exchange for other goods. And so they learned that the barter was very time-consuming, and we used to say in contemporary language, high transaction costs. So it limited the scope of exchange. To overcome this, locally common commodities became money. We call this stage a commodity money. So they use cows, horses, axes, fools, something what was locally typical, and an exchange of product for this commodity money, and then buy the desired, the needed commodity. And this stage was a progress, but was not good enough. It was very difficult to carry. Can you imagine? Horses or cows, to carry as a money. So the more smaller, higher value commodity appeared to play the role, and it was a stage of precious metals, usually gold, silver, or in some culture, jewelries. So, and then this way the coin appeared as a gold or silver, a standardized form of money. Very often, and then with warranty by monarch or city heads, or so this way money started to carry also a symbol of trust in an institution, a power institution. Also the trust between communities exchanging goods and services. This is what I would like to focus on, this aspect, because we, with the coin money, we started moving slowly to money as a symbol of value for many communities. So, of course, the coins and were popular, but they were also prone for robbery, and then people preferred to leave coin or equivalent of gold in the banks, and then banks started issuing banknotes. You could always exchange this, the paper money, but you could exchange them for gold. So this stage was a significant step toward, also, it was very important component of trust, trust in the institutions, banking institutions, and trust in each other, you know, that you use the right banknotes. So, and then it was a very close step to current situation, to the paper money with national currencies granted as in gold reserve and expected tax revenues again. It was, as my friend Jerry and Gary and Ivo published few years ago in excellent article, it was a type of institutionalized trust. The paper money is institutionalized trust in the governance. So it was an important step. And then, since the trade became popular, again, I want to show you the trade, the exchange surpluses was the major engine of economic growth and social development, also opening horizons, opening mind, sharing values, different religions, different culture, different arts. So it was the next step to establish a global currency. After disaster, Second World War, and the messy monetary system, Bretton Woods happened. Bretton Woods was the place, the hotel, in which representatives of 44 nations met in July, spent almost all July 1944, and they coined international monetary system with fixed rate, pegged to gold and US dollar, and convertible for a trade and current transactions. They have also established the institution to monitor functioning the monetary system, the IMF, International Monetary Fund. And also another very important institution which is indirectly connected. All banks are connected with money, but the world, the International Bank of Development, or World Bank, popular enough, to speed up the reconstruction. So we see that we have now, with the fixed exchange rates, with convertibility in gold, you know, we have the global currency, because it was easy to find, to exchange, because we knew that the value, we could use the account value, and we can store, we can fulfill all three basic functions of money. But in August 15, 1971, U.S. suspended as a major player, because we were pegged the system to U.S. dollar, suspended convertibility to gold. And since within 2 years, the currency started floating. So there was end of the Bretton Woods Agreement and end of convertibility in gold. So the U.S. dollar became type of reserve currency. So, and then because it was needed type of reserve currencies and many transactions were happening, when the European Union started to emerge to respond to the disastrous Second World War, there was thinking from the beginning about the common currency. And finally, European monetary system, ICO, was introduced in late 70s. And then was the next step was European Monetary Union and European Central Bank established in 1999 and finally 2002 introduced the coins, money, paper notes in European Union, in those countries which met certain criteria. Again, so money are related to institutions, money are the institutions because they are the rules, standards, also linked with the trust. So anyway, so then the newest event is the peer-to-peer money, Bitcoin, is a very innovative network based on trust and cryptography. It's mathematical system, you know, which proves or secures the system. I will not talk much today. I'm not planning to talk about the Bitcoin system because comparing with 3 or 4 millennia of the money we know, it's very young system. There are some problems with this system, but I don't want to say that this system doesn't have the future. We'll see. So, to sum up this, so money over the millennia became the global institutions with norm roles and standards, but also served to build bridges between different continents, different countries, cultures, and to facilitate learning from each other, to resolve joint problems, big international transactions, so Americans bought for money Alaska, you know, the moving borders. Again, money facilitated building mutual trust and respect, and then leading to peace. So this is, became the real social power. So anyway, but we need to be aware that those who emit the money which plays like global reserve, U.S., and now, I mean, European Union, they have also responsibility and they have certain benefits also. We learned during the last financial crisis and the Greece crisis how important are those who control the emission of money. So, but anyway, for the global community, securing the fair emission of money is a public good. It has a big value. So, stable money, which gives the full interconvertibility, is the real social power. So anyway, how the second question, money, I mean, look, you know, money in general is the neutral instrument. could be used for good or bad purposes. Depends on in which system, what is the institutional setup. They protect the disadvantages or not? Do they facilitate equal distribution of power, or they support monopolies? So it depends how societies are organized. So, as an economist, I would tell you, don't blame money, blame institutional setup. So anyway, so we could see meritocracy when we have the system without monopolies and the value based on merit. We compensate people according to their contribution to help them to maintain their human capital, their knowledge, their skills, their attitudes, you know, and also give them a surplus, you know, to invest in further development, their skills. And then we have the other system. The other extreme is plutocracy. We see tendencies in many countries toward those whose values, I mean, the system linked to the privilege. For instance, we use this 1%, the top income people. If we look from the American point of view, they control, the 1% controls about 20% of wealth in U.S. But if we look at the benefits of recovery package, they took like 70% of benefits. So it means that the institutional setup, particularly tax system, was for privilege 1%. And this is really not fair. This is the policy pushing the country towards plutocracy. So anyway, from economic point of view, also from my personal experience, both monopolies, private or public, are bad. Corporate ownership or public party role or state ownership and the prevailing role in functioning system are both bad and dysfunctional. So from that point of view, the quality of institutions is the basic concern. So if we look at the institutional setup, we should think, you know, how do they create conditions for from economic point of view, I use the term human capital. I'm not talking about people. People are the carriers of human capital. I'm talking about knowledge, skills, attitudes. So do we have that type of situation in the institutional setup encourage investing in human capital? And then we learned also that the social capital is equally important. The more advanced society, the larger the role of the social capital. However, we observe with the development of money that the social capital was built up all the time. The more transaction, the more relation, the better people knew each other, the more trust they had. So, anyway, and this is why we discuss here, and then I, from the money point of view, it's important that building networks which support building certain values, norms, ethical norms, should lead to increase the trust. What we are facing now, and then again, you know, I agree with what was said, we are facing severe crisis of trust at many levels. So investing money, I believe, as an economist, also as an educator for 48 years, that gives human capital freedom, people who possess this capital freedom to act, to be creative. It's good for economy. and for society. This is a real contribution to social power. But even the best human capital is not enough without investing in social capital, because both would produce synergetic effects and multiply efforts leading to institutional change. And this is the way, you know, I think that if we invest, and this is something what we are going to discuss today in different sessions, you know, I don't want to talk too much in details, because we will have another sessions, but we will be looking for the solutions. So my major recommendation, number one recommendation, is to do more investment in human and social capital. And then these are the major factors that will lead institutional change. When they reach the critical mass, we will have the institutional change, abolishing power of economic and political monopolies. And we see, I mean, the cases, I presented two cases, you know, the bad examples of money in politics, because it was the question. The design, the election campaign design in the state, the length, we almost have 2 years long election campaign, while our neighbors, northern neighbors, Canadian, they have only 3 months. And they spent small fraction of this $1 billion spent in U.S. And then if somebody would ask about the quality of the political system, I would rather opt for a Canadian one. And then the last, when was it? I guess 2008 or 2009, I guess, the Supreme Court recognized corporation as, and then was the case, Citizens United, as a person who has the same right as the based on the free speech amendment, you know, so they could actively participate in election in terms of finance election. I think that it was disastrous. It gave the disastrous results. And this is the major focus, at least at Hillary Clinton speeches. And then we hope, you know, that with her victory, we will get rid through the better appointments of Supreme Court. We have vacancy. So anyway, so the big money influence on election is bad, and then it influenced also the market setup. Market setup in which, despite the big crisis, financial crisis, and follow-up economic recession, 2008, 2009, then the market setup was not changed enough to prevent future crises and to limit the power of the Wall Street on politics. So, as a result of this market setup, the middle class in the U.S. is shrinking over the last 40 years. Last 2 years we observed slight growth in the real income of the middle class. During the last 40 years, can you imagine? Why the 1, 5, or 10% incomes, they were growing pretty fast. So, while the riches are getting richer and more powerful, the core of U.S. democracy, middle class, is shrinking. And they were hit hard by the crisis. So, this is what I have already mentioned. We urgently need institutional and policy reforms to get rid of big money in politics. And then my native country, we observed very interesting case in the last election. The Peace and Justice Party made several promises, very populist promises, and one of them was 500 Polish zloty, it's about 130 euro monthly child support. I mean, the conversion is not as important, but you need to be aware this is about 50% of monthly minimum wage. It's quite significant contribution. So, and they also promised, despite the demographic crisis, cutting retirement age from 67 for both genders, which previous government introduced a few years ago, to 65 for men and 60 for women. And there were many other populist ideas. So, what's happened? Money brought about 3.5 million voters with those families who benefited with this program, child support program, and they gained 37% of votes, which the other composition of the parliament, they gave them majority, slight majority, I guess they have in 460 seats parliament, three votes over the majority, so it's not big, but they behave like they have the absolute majority, and they are trying to change it already, constitution. I mean, yesterday, Emil Constantinescu mentioned the significance of the clear division in three types of power, and then we have the serious problem with constitutional court, which was a really type of paralyzed by clear violation of constitution. So anyway, and then who elected them? This is very important, and then Igor, probably he is aware, but because he was talking in similar tendencies in the other countries, so these are less educated people, so-called participatory parochialism. and then poorer, but, you know, much more prone for fear and manipulation, highly dependent also on the significant part of the Polish Catholic Church. But what is interesting, and this is something what is powerful lesson for us, not only the bad thing, but also the positive thing. They were working at least 5-6 years, building networks, different networks, these poor people organized by the party, some affiliated with the church, some with this Smolensk catastrophe, and many type of support groups, 100,000 of these groups, and then they brought this electorate to the polling station. So, again, networking, building social capital is very important, but we need to have good purposes, and so this is the lesson they want this. Anyway, remedies, so in both Polish and the US case, we see how important is investment in human capital. Power of knowledge, yeah, big picture, large leader, and social power of network. We need to have more investment in human social capital to get this critical mass for progressive institutional change toward meritocracy. And then get rid or escape from plutocracy or xenophobia, nationalism, which is very serious problem, populism. And then, as economist, I propose also, I will be talking more in the other session, I hope, about monetization of human and social capital. These type of capital are in disadvantageous position toward financial capital, toward physical capital in general, which particularly financial capital is overpriced. I think that physical capital very often too. So this is somehow we need to change in the way how we do national accountings. And then the last question, I think that wider distribution of money is good only if it motivates people to work. I see a lot of examples when people getting their welfare and they are getting lazy or they are committing crimes or, you know, getting dependent. Dependency of welfare is very significant threat. It leads to the social ills, pathologies. We need to be aware. So I, instead of that, I think that providing more well-designed public goods, like prenatal care, preschool care, education for all, including colleges, we can discuss whether 2 years or 3 years or 4 years, but this is the basic education we should get. And then, you know, we could consider, because I mean, we came back with Gary from European Forum of New Ideas in Sopot last in September, and there was a lot of discussions, this is mostly business and academic community, about basic income concept. So with the technological progress, and this is something what I hope we will discuss also, the role of technology in powering. I know potential discussant on this topic during our session. With automatization, we will have people partly currently unemployed. Should we secure them the basic income to find a job? So anyway, so far the Swiss said no. If the rich Swiss cannot afford, I think there are no more, not many countries could support at this point, but at least we can discuss. Thank you very much for your attention.